story of the faces, which about 45,000 faces were printed for Coraline, about 60,000 faces for Paranorman, and I want to say about 75,000 for the Box Trolls, and closer to 80 or 90,000 faces for Kubo. So it's a lot of faces. Okay. So we have facial librarians tracking all the faces, and there's numbers going to be on the back.
Once the movie's over?
I'm sorry,
Once the movie's over, what happened to all
everything? Once the movie's over, we store everything. We just have a storage area. And now we've actually done two exhibitions at Universal Studios. We did one in August and another one in December, January, where we exhibited several 10 to 12 sets and about 45 puppets down at Universal. And the rest we're storing. We also did an auction. We sold about 250 pieces in last year in a heritage auction. And then keep your eyes out because you never know what could happen. This is another way to animate faces. It's called mechanical animation. So that the armature that I think everybody on this side has seen, if you were to build a facial armature and then cover the face like that, that's a hollow material that goes over, silicone material that just goes over the face. So for the zombie judge, when his mouth moves back and forth, it's so slow that you don't need to replace faces that way. You can build any face like that you want to like this, but it worked really well. You can kind of see he does not have replacement faces. His face is animated by hand like the rest of the world. Right? So you have two options. You can do facial replacement or mechanical. This is called mechanical. When you do print faces, and sometimes you print them in two parts, right? We have upper and a lower part. This way, Coraline, if we just wanted her eyebrows to move, we could actually print just eyebrows and then take it off and put it on, just because we have magnets that can connect. The challenge, you can see on a small puppet, you don't notice that, but when you blow it up this size, you have that huge seam in between upper and lower brow. So we use post-production, we call this compositing or seam removal, basically getting rid of the seam like that. Compositing goes a lot further, and now we're going to get into kind of the visual effects part of a Laika film. You can see on the left side where you have four actual puppets. Those are four puppets that are made. But on the right side, it's the same shot, but there's maybe 20 puppets or so. All the rest of those puppets are actually CG. So you actually shoot it on a green screen and create the puppets in computer, and now you have more puppets, right? You only have to you can build less puppets, but you're still staying true to the whole idea of stop motion and what we do as a stop motion studio. We really are known as a stop motion studio. If you shoot two puppets on a green screen, the possibilities are as limitless as a computer. So, look what you can do in the background here. You can drop in all that background that we just launched right there is all done in computer. So literally two puppets, and then the rest of the background is done on computer. We actually had a set in the back, that cabbage kind of underground area, cave area. We actually have that as a set too. But we can also recreate it and put it in CG, right? So we have the option to do both. I'm going to try to rush through this last part here. But Coraline, I mentioned before, using Coraline to illustrate how we animate smoke, fire, water. There's, if you've seen Kubo, you know there's major things with water, like these huge water waves and things like that. That all has to be done in the computer. So how do we do it? Walk you through what it looks like for Coraline here. This is Coraline just going through a scene here. That's Cotton in the foreground. There's a rig on the back of her, just to get an idea of what the set will look like, so the visual effects team can figure out what they need to bring in. Dry ice. We do this only to see what dry ice or fog would look like when it's moving. You can't animate it, so you can do it in the computer. So basically you can drop in a layer, just like they're doing right here. And so all of that background, all the stuff that's created in the back there, and the fog and everything is all done in the computer. So this goes back to that first slide where Travis and I talked about the idea of the fusion of stop motion and CG. This is a great example. Here's another one right here from the Box Trolls. So shoot this on a green screen, actual puppets. Kind of see what that looks like. We can drop in smoke and light. So on that scene, you can see before you saw the rigs that were holding the puppets up, they're just getting moved frame by frame by frame with the backdrop of the green screen showing all the backgrounds. These These are just some shots from Kubo. And one of the things I was going to talk about, we do a lot of behind the scenes, and like we shoot a lot, almost more than our films itself, capturing things to show what things look like, how it works. This goes back to the Coraline days when we shot this in about 2007. So from a marketing side, this kind of thing is kind of fun. We could play around with it with social media, or you know, put it in some kind of commercial. If you watch the end of our movies, we usually have a funny little interstitial at the end that we drop in. So this is all created content that we can add on to our commercial or commercials or anything. I'm going to show a couple more things and then we'll wrap it. From the marketing, my department is marketing. To come up with ideas to promote our films, we create a lot of vignettes, little featurettes that tell stories about how we create characters, how we build things, how we make things. So for each movie, we probably do an average of 15 to 20 behind the scenes little vignettes that are each about 2 minutes long. Perfect length for either we can pull some of it from ads, we can add some of it to the trailer, or we can do it all on social media. It's becoming, obviously, from Coraline from 2007, when we started promoting Coraline in 2008, to now, social media has just taken off. So we're adjusting to that. But the one thing we really want to show is the story, how it's done. So we work with our distributor, Focus Features. Their parent companies, NBC, Comcast, Universal. Yeah, whatever. Universal Studios, so that's why we're able to partner with them to do things. And here's an example of the making of a pop-up. So the audio is a little bit off, but in about a minute 35, we can show all the tools that are required. That's how you build an armature. And then another group of people step in to put the mold together. You can see all the different hands coming in. These are all different people. We just kept the static shot. Trim away things. And prepare the armature for silicone. Again, lots of trimming, creation. It's going to be a 2 to 3 month process, depending on how soon we've done it. Here's the costume. And then the head. Remember you saw the 70 parts of the head that get attached to the puppet? All the different tools, which we did, and we just removed them in post-production, just got rid of all the hands and everything. Last part was the face. And then what we wanted to do was tie this in the trailer. So he kind of walks into the trailer here. Hashtag for contests, and then you saw Focus Features and Laika in there too. That's all required. Again, think about that first slide, the idea of stop motion with CG. So you saw their actual puppet. So all that water spraying off of the waves is all created in computer, the rain, in the computer, the moon, the lighting. But the rest you can see is actual puppets. So what you see there is actual sets of puppets going again. So the Norman puppet on that bridge, which is tactile, but all those people, all the grasses, the trees, houses, all done on a computer. Lanterns, all those are lit and done in computer. Water done in computer. You can't hold water still. It moves. It just blew it so that you would be able to stop. So here's Kubo running through the scene again with characters, explosions, wings, but the action with the puppet on a green screen. See that's actual puppet. I watch monkey carefully. I think it's coming up here. Point of view shot. Characters in the hollow bones. Okay, this is where the skeleton was. again, remember, these are all scale. That's a skeleton scale, 18 feet, holding the actual size puppet. Okay, you saw that thing that just came off of Monkey, that's the rig. The rig pulls the puppet to the stage and enables it to move around. We often will create, like those clouds, we'll actually create them out of different materials to show what it should look like when we're doing it here. So again, Kubo swimming underwater with the actual 12-foot puppet. But the rest of those guarded eyes were done in here. And rain and smoke. Here, the boat, actual pieces of puppets interacting. Again, guard device, so just remember, one is real, the rest on a green screen are done in CG. The boat is real, that part of it, and then you saw the rest that was brought in. Observing things. I know that sounds counterintuitive, but observing the way things like the way water moves, it's constant to get an idea of scale, scope, how things move. This is a Kubo interacting with a blue beast. That's an actual puppet. Almost the entire puppet was done on a 3D printer. It's our first 3D printed puppet. It has a metal armature though. This gives you an idea of why it takes so long to make these movies, even though you have 450 or so people working. The animators make up only a very small percentage, only about 30 animators total, the stop motion animators. All those metal things in the back of that puppet, again, were rigs.